just going to tell us about the integration paradox of AdS CFT.
Okay, so thank you very much for inviting me here to this wonderful school. It's a real, real pleasure to be here. So I'm going to speak about the information paradox, and I'm going to be using the blackboard. And I realized while sitting at the back that it's sometimes hard to see. So if you can't read what I'm writing, just let me know. And of course, I'd encourage you to come up a little if that's difficult. So let me start by just giving you a brief introduction and an overview of what I'm going to talk about. So as you know, the information paradox is a very old problem in quantum gravity, now almost 40 years old. And before I go on, and I'm going to talk about recent developments in the information paradox that have been inspired by the work of Mathur and Almeri, Marolf, Pulchinski, Stanford, and Sully, and many others. And I'm going to speak about these developments and our resolution and various other recent work about this. But before I go into all that, let me try and give you an outlook and an overview of what the old information paradox was, just to give you a cartoon of what we are going to talk about, and also to tell you what the commonalities of this, of what was earlier called the information paradox, with what is now studied is. So one way of thinking about the information paradox is as follows. So some of you might remember when the LHC was about to start up, there was a court case in Texas saying that the LHC would create black holes. So let's say the allegations made by this guy in Texas were actually true. And it was true that you took the CMS, and in one of its runs, it actually formed a black hole. Okay, this would be a very small black hole, much smaller than this. Okay, so let's say you formed a small black hole. Okay, and this is the Texas theory. And now you do the calculation. This black hole that you formed, the CMS is about 10,000 tons, and you can this is still much larger than the Planck mass, and you can analyze the dynamics of this black hole, and you would find that in about 2 days, if you work out the numbers, in about 2 days, okay, by means of Hawking radiation, this would turn into featureless black body radiation. So now the information paradox is a statement that you started out with this very intricate detector, which so many people spend so much time working on and spend so much technology developing. And then some catastrophe has happened, and it's turned into this perfectly black body thermal radiation. And in fact, this catastrophe is so severe that it looks like this black body radiation has absolutely no information about what went into forming it. And this looks, in fact, like it's in contradiction with a very fundamental tenet of quantum mechanics, which is that evolution should be reversible. You should be able to run time forward and backward. And while it's possible to go from here to here, and you can even compute to some approximation what the final state is while starting with the CMS, it's very hard, or it looks like it's almost impossible to reverse this process and to recover all the details of the detector from the endpoint. Yes. Yes.
CMS.
Oh, the CMS that's here. Yes, yes, yes. Sorry, I'm not saying this seriously. This is just a joke. I'm just trying to illustrate what is happening. I'm not saying this detector will really form a black hole. Okay. So now the question is, how do you go from here to here? And this is in some sense the information paradox. And if you think about it, the essence of the information paradox is that it's a conflict between effective field theory versus quantum mechanics. And effective field theory tells you that this is what the process is approximately. Doesn't tell you about this process, but tells you that once you have a black hole, the black hole evaporates and becomes radiation, whereas quantum mechanics tells you that things should be reversible, and it looks like these two things are in conflict. Okay, so that's a cartoon of what the information paradox was. Now, there were some old resolutions to this, and especially after the advent of AdS CFT, the standard answer to a question of this kind was that effective field theory is not precise enough to set up a contradiction with the principles of quantum mechanics. In particular, maybe this black body radiation contains all the information about the original detector, because the particle that went off in this direction is exponentially, is correlated, but in a very, very small fashion with a particle that went off in this direction. So if you look at this black body radiation extremely closely, you find that there are e to the minus s correlations preserve information. Okay, so this was the standard answer. This was a standard answer to the information paradox for many years, at least after AdS CFT was developed, and everyone accepted this for about 15 years. Now, what has happened in the past few years is that people have tried to refine the information paradox and have tried to come up with more sophisticated arguments, saying that you can't give an answer as fast as this, and they're going to come up with, as I'll try and describe in the second and third lectures, there are these arguments in which it looks like various corrections are under control, and it looks like you really have a contradiction in trying to keep principles of effective field theory consistent with quantum mechanics. So in some sense, the main thrust of my talk over the next few days is going to be to try and bring out this resolution, this conflict first between effective field theory and quantum mechanics, which looks like something very strange. You know, you wouldn't imagine that you could set up such a contradiction, but it turns out that you can. And then I'm going to try and describe, you know, resolutions to this conflict that we've developed over the past few years. And I'm also going to try and describe some other work in progress if I get to that in the last talk. So that's a very quick overview of what I'm going to say. Let me start let me give you a slightly more detailed overview. So today, I'm just going to talk about effective field theory about a black hole. Okay. Tomorrow, I'll try and speak about, I'll try and talk about how you can set up these contradictions between effective field theory and the principles of quantum mechanics. And the way you set up these contradictions is by trying to construct local operators from the CFT. And there are these arguments of paradoxes that tell you that you can't construct these operators, which I'll describe in detail tomorrow. Then I'll try and describe a construction that we have, an explicit construction which exploits some loopholes in these paradoxes. And if I get time, I'll speak about work in progress in the fourth lecture. It depends on how the first three lectures go, so the fourth lecture is a little flexible, but I'll speak about some work in progress in the fourth lecture if I get to that, or I might end up just expanding on these first three things. So this is a more detailed overview of what I'm going to say. So today I'm going to spend a lot of my time just talking about quantum fields propagating about an AdS black hole. It's a relatively simple topic that some of you might have studied, but yet it's confusing enough that even now, sometimes people there are many misconceptions about this, and so it's useful just to understand this and to revisit it, because this is going to play an important role over the next few days. So I'm going to speak about, I'll start just by talking about effective field theory about an AdS black hole. Okay. Are there any questions about this overview and very broad plan of what I'm going to say? Okay, so before I say anything about quantum field theory, let me try and give you a sense of the geometry that we are looking at. So the geometry that we are looking at, that we are going to consider, schematically you should think of it this way. You have anti-de Sitter space, and from the boundary at some point of time, you inject some matter. This matter goes and collapses into a black hole. Okay, and we want to look at the region much after this matter has been injected, and the classical no-hair theorems tell us that you inject this matter, and if you look at this region R, okay, that's this patch here. I hope you can see at the back. Okay, there's some matter here, and there's this patch here. And if you if you take this patch R to be in a region that's late enough, scrambling time after this matter has collapsed to form the black hole, you expect that basically space has settled down and all the details of what constituted the initial black hole have gone away, have died off exponentially, and now you're left with some featureless black hole geometry. So we are going to ask questions about this R, but it's important to keep in mind that the picture we have is that of a black hole formed by the collapse of a pure state. Okay, so it's a black hole which is formed by collapse. It's not an eternal black hole. At some point in the far past, there was empty AdS, and then someone came in and injected a shell of matter. That shell of matter collapsed, and I'm looking at the geometry far after the collapse. So if you look at the geometry much after the collapse, we know to a very good approximation what it looks like outside. So the geometry, the metric here in the region outside, the metric looks like, so it's 1 over z squared. Okay, so I'm working in, this is strictly actually not an AdS black hole, but an AdS black brain, which is infinitely extended in some d minus 1 directions. So this is in AdS d plus 1. D minus 1. Okay. This function h is something that you get from the solution of the Hilbert-Einstein equations. Where z0 to the power d. Okay. The boundary is as z goes to 0. The horizon is as z goes to z0. This black hole has a temperature that you can compute. In fact, in a sense, we will compute it at the end of this lecture, but there's a temperature that's well known, and that temperature is this. Okay, so this is the geometry that we're looking at, and this is the picture that we have. Of course, this geometry is valid just outside the horizon, and so it's important to make a change of coordinates to try and extend this geometry to the region inside the horizon. And to do that, the first thing you do is you define these things called tortoise coordinates, which are going to be very useful for us. And the tortoise coordinates are defined so that dz squared by h is equal to h into dz star squared. Okay. So they're defined so that you can pull out a factor of h so that you have something that looks like minus dt squared plus dz star squared. Okay, that's the purpose of defining these coordinates in this manner. And you can work out what these things are. Tells you that dz star by dz is minus 1 by h. The minus sign is chosen for convention. You could choose some different convention in which it was plus 1 by h. Okay. But anyway, you can define these coordinates. You can solve this differential equation. The precise solution to this differential equation involves some hypergeometric functions, which we are not interested in. But the important thing is that you choose the boundary at z star goes to 0. Okay. And now you want to ask what happens to this coordinate z star as you start approaching the horizon, which is here. So as you start approaching the horizon, you can check that what happens to this z coordinate . Okay, this is approaching z0 from below. As you approach z0 from below, remember that the boundary is at z equal to 0. So as you approach the horizon from outside, that's approaching z0 from below. As you approach z0 from below, you find that h of z, you can work out, it's a simple calculation, by z0, okay? And so z star . Okay, well, this constant depends on some details and on the fact that you set some boundary condition on z star as you went to the boundary. Okay, so and this is all just elementary manipulations. You can work this out by just taking this form of h of z and differentiating it, taking the first derivative near z0, and then you can use this differential equation of dz star by dz is minus 1 by h to work out the solution that you have for z star in the region near the horizon. Okay, and you can see from here that z star tends to go to minus infinity as you go to the horizon. Goes to minus infinity. Okay, and you can see from that formula that z star tends to go to minus infinity. Now, to extend the metric to the region behind the horizon, okay, it's useful to make a few more manipulations. Where should I go? Okay. The first is to you re-express h in terms of, there's some constant into e to the dz star. Z0, okay, and this you can check is some constant into e to the 4 pi by beta into z star. Okay. So if you re-express this H using that solution back in terms of Z star, you find there's some constant, which depends on this constant that we had here. Okay, so there's some constant that's related to the exponential of that constant. And you find that there's some relationship that tells you that H goes like e to the 4 pi by beta Z star. Okay. Now, presumably all of you have seen this, so I'll go through this fast. Is there any reason? So you redefine some new coordinates. These are like your Kruskal coordinates. Once again, you know, the details of these coordinate definitions are not important. You can go back and look up these formulas in our paper and many other papers. I'm just trying to give you a sense of what happens. So you define these Kruskal coordinates, again with some constant gamma, which I'm not so interested in, minus t, and you define some Kruskal coordinate v, which is again some gamma, which is a constant which I'm not going to be interested in. And in terms of these coordinates, if you look at this metric that we had upstairs, which has unfortunately gone to the top of the board, but hopefully you have in your notes, you see that your metric, if you choose this constant gamma correctly, starts looking just as du dv by z0 squared plus dxi squared by z0 squared with the right choice of this constant gamma. So your metric near the horizon starts looking precisely like the metric of flat space near the horizon. Okay? And the horizon, in fact, is not a very special region. In these coordinates, the horizon is just at u equal to 0. Okay? So the horizon, which was this region, maybe I'll draw this again. I can draw this again, actually, here. Z0 is the radius of the horizon, yes. It's an unimportant constant here. You can scale it away by coordinate transformation. It's just convention.
And you want to do some regularization?
Yeah? No, there's no regularization here. Well, there's no regularization here. Okay. So, just remind you, okay, this boundary, this is u equal to 0, z star equals minus infinity. Okay. You can check also that this region, in fact, allows you finite values of v. So this horizon is at u equal to 0, v finite, and t equal to plus infinity. Okay. All these properties I'm writing here are properties of this region of the horizon, which is, in fact, the region we are going to focus on throughout the rest of the lecture, and, in fact, in the next few lectures as well. So everything I'm writing here is a statement about what's true about the horizon. And this you can get just from simple coordinate transforms. Now, as you cross the horizon, u goes from being positive to being slightly negative. So you can introduce a second Schwarzschild patch behind the horizon, and that's by inserting a minus sign here. Okay. So the idea is that you start with some Schwarzschild coordinates. You start with some Schwarzschild coordinates in front of the horizon. You define some coordinates u and v without any minus sign. You use these coordinates to analyze the structure of the horizon. You find that the metric looks just like the metric of flat space. Okay, so nothing special is happening at the horizon. The horizon is at u equal to 0. You cross the horizon, and then you find that you can introduce a second Schwarzschild patch, but with some slightly different relations between u and v. The relation between v and z star and t remains the same, but you insert a minus sign for the u, and now you can set up a second Schwarzschild-like coordinate system in which the metric looks the same as the metric did earlier in the Schwarzschild coordinates, which you have in your notes, except that the relation between u and v and this is slightly different. Okay? So if you look at the region inside the horizon, it again has z star equal to minus infinity and t equal to plus infinity, and then t decreases as you go towards this direction, and z star increases. as you go away from the horizon. This actually increases in slightly different direction. Okay. But the point is that the horizon is at these extreme values. As you go away, this happens. And the opposite is happening from here. Okay. So are there any questions about this geometry? This is just some basic statements about the geometry of this black hole that we're going to be interested in, and some basic coordinate transformations that we use, which is important for everything we're going to say. Yeah?
What about the singularity?
The singularity is far away. It's at some region which is uv is equal to plus 1 in these coordinates. So singularity is some hyperbola. If I draw it correctly, it's far away. It's still z equal to 0. So I'm not going to be anywhere near the singularity. If you remember, let me just draw it here. Okay, so I'm always going to be interested in a region here. This is my region R. Region is far away from the infalling matter. It's far away from the singularity. It's a region when everything is smooth, and so we think we understand everything just in terms of effective field theory. So I'm never going to say anything about the singularity in these lectures. Okay? Okay, good. Yeah.
So far, this could be an eternal black hole?
This is not an eternal black hole. If I wanted to make it an eternal black hole, I'd have to extend this to regions 3 and 4. I'd have to extend this geometry further. I'm not going to do that, but it's true that everything I've said so far would also be true for an eternal black hole, but it's important for me conceptually that this is not an eternal black hole and is formed from collapse of a pure state. It will be important in the next few lectures. So far, everything I said about the geometry outside is also true for an eternal black hole. Okay, good. Now let me start by asking some questions about quantum field theory on this background. Okay? So now when I ask about quantum field theory on this background, the fundamental object that I want to construct is some field, which is phi fx. Okay? So now you could ask, you know, what is this field phi fx? You know, when you write down phi fx, what do you mean even by this point x? Now usually when you do quantum field theory, it's not very important because you have some coordinate system and gravity is non-dynamical. But in all this discussion of the information paradox, gravity is very important, as we'll see. And so it's very important to define what you mean by phi fx. And the reason this is something which is slightly tricky, I can erase all these formulas now. The only thing that's important is presumably that picture on the right-hand side. Nothing else about the details of these formulas is important. The reason this is important is that in gravity, there is no such thing as a local gauge invariant observable. So even if you think of a scalar and you do a diffeomorphism, this scalar transforms in this way. Okay? So if you were to integrate the scalar over some manifold, it's true that that would be something that's gauge invariant, but that wouldn't be something that's local. So in gravity, you don't have something like a local gauge invariant observable, and this is something that Daniel also alluded to, I think, in his lectures, at least in some tangential way. However, in the situation of AdS, so one more reason, and this is something which is useful to understand, one more way to state the fact that you don't have local gauge invariant observables in gravity is to think that a gauge invariant observable is one that has zero charge. Okay? But to have zero charge in gravity, you need to have zero energy because gravity couples to energy. And so you can't localize something that's gauge invariant. It has to be something that's integrated. Nevertheless, in AdS, because of the presence of the boundary, you can come up with something that's not quite local, but that you expect gives you some approximation to local physics. And you can do that because you have a boundary, and you can define observables relationally with respect to the boundary. So in particular, the way you want to define this phi fx, let me extend this region a little further so I have some more space, is that you start with some point in the boundary, here's some point p, and then you jump in a particular direction, which you can define because you have a sense of the asymptotic boundary conditions. You fall for some proper time tau, and then you reach some point x. Okay? And this is the x that I put into this field. I can cross the horizon this way as well. Right now, x could be outside or inside the horizon.
Okay. Do you mean the horizon per x, the diffeomorphism invariant?
Sorry, I didn't understand. No, sorry, what's the question?
Do you mean the horizon, the presence of horizon per x, the diffeomorphism invariant.
No, 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 I'm not saying anything breaks the diffeomorphism invariance. I'm saying that you can't define gauge invariant observables, but because of the presence of the boundary, you can define some other observables relationally with respect to the boundary, which look like they would give you an approximation of local physics. So in particular, the way I define the observable is that I think of the experience of an observer who starts from a given point on the boundary and falls in a given direction along a certain geodesic or some other path for a certain proper time and reaches, you know, somewhere in the bulk. And then this observer measures the field, and I ask, what does this observer measure? Now, the observable I just defined is not a local observable because it's defined with relation to the boundary. Okay? Nevertheless, it's gauge invariant under all gauge transformations that leave the boundary invariant. It's not quite gauge invariant under large gauge transformations that shift the boundary, but that's okay, you know, because you always allowed things that shift under large diffeomorphisms. But you know, you're not allowed things that are not well defined under small diffeomorphisms. I'll say a little more about this in the fourth lecture. I don't want to emphasize or spend dwell too much on this point. But for those of you who are thinking about this carefully, and you wonder what people talk about when they talk about these local fields in gravity, one way to make this precise is to define it relationally with respect to the boundary. This is not something you can do in some other space if you don't have a boundary. Now, if you had a compact manifold and you had to define time or you had to define a sense of a local observable, that's something that's much harder to do. But in AdS, you're slightly better off, and you can define these local observables, quasi-local observables, relationally with respect to the boundary. It's not observer dependence. It's just some observable that's defined with respect to the boundary. It's a particular gauge choice, if you like. Yeah.
So you're saying that we cannot think of asymptotically flat space as the limit where the radius of AdS goes to infinity. This sort of like definition of observables would break down naively.
Well, if you try to define observables in flat space by taking some flat space limit of this kind, yeah, I think you would have some difficulty because, you know, I'll try and define these observables a little more precisely in the next lecture. So you have to define them more precisely by talking about the affine parameter and talking about something that's finite. If you try to take some limit of this kind, you wouldn't really reach anywhere in the bulk by doing that in some flat space limit. So yeah, it's harder to define these observables in flat space, I think. I mean, Okay, good. So now let me say, you know, what do you want from this field phi? You want it to be a perturbative field, so you want it to satisfy some wave equation. I'm going to just list some conditions. These are not necessarily logically either independent or necessary or sufficient, but they're just some conditions that we want from local fields. You want it to satisfy an equation of this kind. You want its correlations functions to factorize. Now, the reason the correlations functions factorize up to 1 by n is because that's the only parameter that you have in AdS CFT. There's no hierarchy of interactions. The gravitational interaction is 1 by n, and all other interactions are 1 by n. And so you believe that you write down some 2n point function of this kind, it factorizes into a product of 2-point functions plus something that's suppressed by 1 by n. And so the important object in everything we are going to consider is basically these 2-point functions. Okay? Now we are going to demand some additional properties from these 2-point functions, just from the 2-point functions. And the 2-point functions have the following properties. We want this field to satisfy the canonical commutation relations. So if I've been writing x here, but I'm just going to make this equal time for a second. I've introduced a t not because I've introduced an additional coordinate, but just to point out that these are equal time commutation relations. So you want them to satisfy the canonical commutation relations, which will be important. And there's a property which will be important for us quite a lot in the last part of this lecture, which is that you want the short distance behavior of this 2-point function to be fixed. In fact, you can say something about the general 2-point function even at long distances, but there's something very intuitive, which is that if you go to short distances, then whatever the details, even if you have an interaction theory, as long as you have some quantum field theory that is controlled by an ultraviolet-free fixed point, and you go to very short distances or you go very close to the light cone, then you believe that the 2-point function has a universal structure, and the universal structure is as follows. if you take these two points to be very close to each other on the light cone, then the statement is that this two-point function becomes something universal. It becomes x2 to the d minus 1. Okay. And remember, we are in AdS d plus 1 dimension. So this is the bulk dimension minus 2. So this is, for example, the familiar statement that in four dimensions, the two-point function has a structure which is 1 by x1 minus x2 squared. Of course, it's important that this x1 minus x2 is measured with whatever the metric is. Okay? It's important that this is measured with, this is the distance measured with the appropriate metric in these coordinates. But this is a rather universal result about quantum field theories, any quantum field theory that's controlled by an ultraviolet-free fixed point. Okay? So we are going to try and demand these conditions from this field and try and see how far we get. Now, it turns out to be very useful to look at the near horizon region, which is this region. Once again, I'm looking at the region R, but I'm looking at the region close to the horizon and try and see what this leads us to. Push this far. Why do I assume it's free in the EV? Okay, because I want to construct some perturbative fields which don't have, if you have non-trivial fixed points, it might be a little more complicated. So for now, I'm going to construct some perturbative fields which have some simple structure in the UV. You could try and think of things that are more complicated, but for now, let me restrict to these things. I think the whole situation might be more complicated if you had fields which were, you know, which had some non-trivial fixed point and were controlled by some non-trivial fixed point. So. Good. So now let's look at the wave equation near the horizon. Yes. Yes, please go on. Question? Okay, so if you look at the wave equation near the horizon, I just want to point out some salient features. The wave equation looks like this, the wave equation we just wrote down. Okay, and in these coordinates that we wrote down, remember, in these z star t coordinates, root minus g is just h of z. Okay, and however, gtt is equal to gz star is 1 by h of z. Okay. So your wave equation becomes as follows. It becomes, if you just write this wave equation, it becomes 1 by h z dt squared phi minus dz star squared phi minus dxi squared phi is equal to 0. Okay. So you can have whatever value you like for dxi squared phi, but the dispersion relation turns out not to depend on the momentum at all. So if you look at solutions to this wave equation, they're rather peculiar. The solutions look like this. K dot x, e to the minus omega t, e to the I omega z star. And this omega z star is related to the omega of t, and doesn't depend on this k at all. And the reason for that is that, as I said, you know, as you go near the horizon, h of z tends to diverge. And so this term tends to dominate this term, whatever the value of k. Okay? So if you go close enough to the horizon, you're forced to these solutions of the wave equation, where this term doesn't, you know, this radial momentum, the momentum in the z star direction, doesn't depend on this k at all. Okay? So that's a peculiarity of the solutions of the wave equation near the horizon, which is useful to keep in mind, okay, which will be important for us. Good. Now, let's say you try and write down the expansion of the field. Let me try and write down the expansion of the field. In terms of these solutions to the wave equation, so you would write down some expansion dd minus 1 k, 2 pi to the d, d omega, by root 2 omega, into a omega k, minus I omega t, plus I k dot x. Okay. I'm just going to explain this in a second. Z star minus I delta. Plus summation conjugate. Okay. So if you just take, you know, if you just take the class, so the, you know, rules of quantizing semi-classical fields, you take all the solutions of classical equations of motion, and you try and quantize that phase space of solutions by means of coefficients of this kind. So I'm just following the usual rules of semi-classical quantization, except that what I put in here, which I didn't mention before, was that I want the solution to be normalizable at infinity. Okay? So this field that I'm considering, I don't want it to diverge at infinity. I want it to be normalizable at infinity. So wherever, you know, this field has a property that it dies off as z to the d as z goes to 0. Okay? And if you put in that condition, so I should write this more precisely. Okay. If you put in the condition that it, as z goes to 0, the field dies off as z to the d, then as you go near horizon, you find that this is the expansion of the field. Okay? And these phases of e to the I delta and e to the minus I delta come from this condition. They come because you have standing waves in some sense. Now, this is the statement that AdS is like a box, and if you impose some boundary conditions on one side of the box, you get some standing waves, and those standing waves have some coefficients between the left and the right movers, which are respectively these two guys. And other than that, the expansion near horizon is very simple. I want to emphasize again that this is the expansion as z goes to z0. Okay? In general, if you tried to write down an expansion that was valid for all regions in z, then you would have to replace these simple mode functions with something that's more complicated. You can compute that more complicated thing, but I want to emphasize how many of the results you can get very simply by just considering the near horizon region where the mode functions are very simple, just like the mode functions are in flat space. Okay? So the moment I do this and I demand the canonical commutation relations that I demanded in the blackboard behind this, you find that, you know, you'll immediately get some commutation relations for the A omegas, which are the A omega k, A dagger omega prime k prime. This looks like delta of omega minus omega prime, delta d minus 1 of k minus k prime. Okay? And this just comes from the standard commutation relations and demanding that they hold in the near horizon region. Okay? Okay. Now, you can ask what happens as you go to the region behind the horizon. So far, everything I was saying was true of the region in front of the horizon. Now, you could go to the region behind the horizon. And there you find, once again, that you have solutions of this kind. You see, the metric behind the horizon, as I emphasized at the beginning, is the same as the metric in front of the horizon. So once again, the solutions that you get are of this kind, except that you don't have this relation between the left and the right movers, because this region is now, you know, not connected to the boundary in any sense. Okay? So you can write down another expansion. So z, this is z goes to z0 minus. You can write down another expansion. Which is phi is z goes to z0 plus. And that expansion is the same. Okay. D omega dd minus 1 k 2 pi to the d 2 omega. Okay. Now you have some other coefficients. I'll establish a relationship between them in a second. Omega t. Get my signs right. Good. Sorry, I just want to get my signs correct and not make a mistake here. Sorry, I'm just going to follow conventions. Well, minus sign here, and minus sign here. Sorry, so this is now the expansion in the region behind the horizon. Let me just say a couple of things about this expansion. I hope those of you at the back can see. I'm sorry. I hope those of you at the back can see, and this is not too unclear. Okay. So this is, you know, I have some two new coefficients. I had some coefficients A. You know, everything in front of the horizon was expressed in terms of the coefficients A. Now I introduce some A prime and this A tilde. I'm going to get rid of this A prime in a second. But notice that this is a destruction operator. Okay? It multiplies an e to the minus I omega t into an e to the minus I omega z star. This is another destruction operator, but it multiplies an e to the plus I omega t and an e to the minus I omega z star. And the reason for this is, if you look at the region behind the horizon, then the role of time is played by z star. The coordinate that you're calling t by introducing the second Schwarzschild patch behind the horizon is now a space-like coordinate, and the time-like coordinate is the coordinate z star. And therefore, the issue of whether an operator is time, you know, is a destruction or a creation operator is controlled by how it behaves with respect to z star and not with respect to t. Therefore, even though this is a destruction operator, it's multiplied with an e to the plus I omega t because this is the one that's important. Okay? Okay. Now, if you look at this in the original UV coordinates, you'll find that this guy can be written just as e to the minus I omega into t plus z star. Okay? So I can write this as t plus z star. That's I k dot x. And this is a coordinate that we were calling v some time back. If you remember, we made a coordinate redefinition calling this coordinate e to the t plus z star v, and this coordinate was what was finite at the horizon and had some range, you know, finite range as you went through the horizon. Therefore, if you want this expansion as you approach z0 from behind the horizon to be continuous with this expansion, then you would like this a prime guy to be the same as the A operators that we had there. Okay? But you cannot say the same about these A tilde guys, these A twiddle guys, which are some different operators because they're multiplying something that depends on U. Okay? And the horizon is at U equal to 0, and so you can't use the condition of continuity to relate these A twiddle guys to something that lives in front of the horizon. I'm going to say, I'll just try and make this a little more physical in a couple of minutes. But for now, this is just something that's true about solutions of the classical equations of motion. Okay? And as I said, there's a peculiarity about these guys, which is that if you look at the commutator with the Hamiltonian, then h of a omega is minus a omega, but h with this twiddle a omega is plus omega a twiddle omega. Okay? And that's because of the wrong sign with this t that I mentioned. Okay. Now let me say a little more about these guys and what are the kinds of two-point functions that they must have. So the last thing I want to do is try and claim that these A's and A twiddles have to have certain. So these A twiddles are some new modes, okay, are some new coefficients that we need because there are some separate solutions of the equations of motion, and you can easily work out that these guys have to have the same commutation relations amongst themselves, but they have to commute with the A, you know, with the A guys. So the A twiddle omega into the A twiddle dagger omega prime is once again delta of omega minus omega prime. I'm omitting the K index, but the A twiddle omega with the A omega is 0. Okay? So it turns out that the moment you go to the region behind the horizon, you need some new operators which need to multiply these right moving solutions that live behind the horizon. Okay? And they have these properties in that they have the wrong commutator with the Hamiltonian that you would expect of a destruction operator, and they commute with the operators in front of the horizon. Okay? Now, let me just try and spend about 15 minutes, right? Good. Let me try and say something about two-point functions. So this is the only computation I'll try and do in this, the detailed computation I'll try and do, which I think is nice and illuminating. I'm going to claim that in whatever the state of the black hole is, there are certain universal two-point functions that these A's and A twiddles have to have, and those are as follows. So the claim is that in the black hole geometry, you find, independent of the value of k. Okay? The claim is that you have to have this two-point function between the A's and the A stars, and you also have to have a non-zero two-point function between the A's and the twiddle A's, but not between a creation and an annihilation operator, but between an annihilation and an annihilation operator. is okay. I'll try and show you why this two-point function is now necessary to fulfill the last condition that we wrote down, which is that the two-point function of the fields has to have a certain universal form as you go to short distances. Okay? So in particular, I'm going to use the expansions that I wrote down for the field and go to two points, one of which is in the same region R and is at this point, P1, just outside the horizon, and another point which is in the region R and is at the point P2, but slightly inside the horizon. But both of these points are approaching each other. And I'm going to try and show that in order for that two-point function to have the right form, you have to have this two-point function between the A's and the 8 widdles. Okay? So this is the computation I'm going to do. I'll try and spend 5 minutes on doing the computation. And let me know if you have questions. And then I'll try and spend the last 5 minutes just taking a recap and trying to say more physically what has happened for those of you who might be getting lost in solutions of classical equations of motion. Okay, good. So remember that if you look at these points P1 and P2, I said that the metric near the horizon was basically a flat metric. And so you expect that you look at this two-point function, and it has a very simple form. It has a form that looks like 1 by delta u, delta v, plus delta x squared by z0 squared by z0 squared to the power d minus 1 by 2. This is just what we said. The two-point function has to be, as you take these points, P1 goes to P2. Okay. Let me take a slightly more precise limit. Let me take the limit where delta V goes to 0. Okay. And let me do something slightly more with this two-point function, which is let me differentiate it with respect to U. Okay. You'll see in a second why I'm doing this. But for now, I'm allowed to do whatever I like once I have this form. I'm allowed to differentiate it. So I'll differentiate this with u. Differentiate this with u. Okay. And I'm going to take delta v goes to 0. And after that, I'm going to take delta u goes to 0. But first, I'll take delta v goes to 0. Okay. If I differentiate this twice with respect to u, you see that I'll just pull out a factor of delta v squared. Because every time I differentiate with respect to u, I pull out a factor of v, okay, and I increase this coefficient from d minus 1 to d plus 3. Okay, and I get some constant, which I'm not going to bother about. Okay, so there's some constant, which I have some notes, and I worked out the constant in the notes, but I won't work it out on the board. Okay. Why am I differentiating? I'm just differentiating. It'll become obvious in a second. I beg your pardon? No, I didn't change the dimension. I differentiated twice with respect to the u coordinate that sits here. Okay? Delta u is u of p1 minus u of p2. And delta v is. So I'm taking two points which have some coordinates u1, u2, v1, and v2. I'm looking at the two-point function. The two-point function has a certain universal form. Now I'm looking at the derivative of the two-point function because I feel like looking at that derivative. It'll become clear why I feel like looking at the derivative. And I'm saying that it has this form. For now, I haven't motivated why I'm looking at the derivative. Okay? But it has this form. Now, the statement is, I'm going to claim that if you look at this limit as delta v tends to 0, this actually becomes a delta function in this delta x coordinate. Okay? And the way you see that is by trying to do an integral of this coordinate over delta x. Okay? So I claim that this object, if you take the limit as delta v goes to 0, is actually a delta function in this delta x. And the way you see that is by trying to do an integral over this, okay, over the x coordinates. And you can change variables to a new variable, okay, which is alpha, which is delta x by delta u delta v. Okay. And you'll find that your integral looks like 0, 1 by delta u squared, okay, into an integral d of d minus 1 alpha by 1 plus alpha squared. You get a factor from the change in the measure when you make this change of variables, and you get a factor from this denominator, and you find that the factors of delta v cancel completely. Okay? And so this integral is independent. I mean, it only depends on you. Okay. On the other hand, you know, clearly, if you're in some region where delta x is non-zero, okay, if you're in some region where delta x is non-zero, then this integrand vanishes as you take the limit as delta v goes to zero. Okay, so the integrand vanishes whenever delta x is non-zero. But the integral is something which is independent of delta v, okay, which means that this integrand must be proportional to a delta function in delta x. Okay, so the claim is that you look at this two-point function, and this two-point function is proportional to a delta function in delta x. So let me just write that down separately. And this feature of the two-point function is what's sometimes called ultra-locality in light cone physics. Okay, so it's this statement of ultra-locality, which is a very fancy-sounding term, is simply this statement, that you look at the two-point function, you take a particular limit as the two points sit in the light cone, and you find the two-point function becomes ultra-local in the transverse directions. Okay, so there are these directions, u and v, along the light cone. You're differentiating them. Sorry, I forgot to take a derivative. You're differentiating them with respect to u, and you're taking the v coordinate tending to each other, and you find that it becomes ultra-local in these transverse directions. Okay, this would not have happened if I had not taken this derivative, and that's why it was important to take this universal form to take this derivative. Okay, okay. Now I want to tell you how you get this form by imposing this two-point function and by using the mode expansion that we had above. Okay, just 2 minutes more, and then I'll recap and say something. Okay, maybe I'll sketch the calculation since I'm running out of time. But the basic fact is as follows. You see, if you take one of these points in front of the horizon and the other point behind the horizon, and you write down these e to the I omega t minus z stars and t plus z stars, and you focus on the term that involves this two-point function, you'll find, sorry, I'm just going to sketch this calculation, but I have some notes which I'm happy to give you since I'm running out of time. We're going to be strict with time, right? 5 minutes. 5 minutes. Okay, good. Fine. So then I'll just sketch the calculation. Okay. So if you just focus on this term, you'll find that you have some term that looks like a omega k a twiddle omega k, okay, into u1 by u2 I omega beta by 2 pi. Okay. And this is integrated over omega and k, dk, k, okay? So if you just focus on this and you put in these delta functions, which I absorbed for a second, you find that this two-point function has this plus some other terms. Okay? The fact that this two-point function doesn't depend on k, there should be a delta. It has no dependence on k except for this delta function, immediately gives you this ultra-locality when you do this integral over k. Okay? So the fact that there's no dependence of this two-point function, this e to the minus beta omega, has no dependence on k, immediately gives you this ultra-locality. And so you find immediately from the near horizon expansion that you get this ultra-locality. And then you're left with some other term. And now I just want to point out that if you put in this form of the two-point function, you will indeed get this 1 by delta u squared. And the way you get that is rather nice. Now you differentiate this twice. Okay. If you differentiate this, you get this minus 1 into 1 by u2 squared. Okay. You have an integral here over omega. You have an integral over omega because there's one other term that depends on a omega dagger into a tilde omega dagger. I'm just going to do the sketch. But you can use the symmetry of this to convert this integral from an integral from 0 to infinity to an integral from minus infinity to infinity. And then you find that when you insert this object, if you insert this ansatz, this ansatz has poles precisely at beta omega equal to 2 pi I. Okay? This guy has poles . So you can do the omega integral by doing a contour integral. You can close it either in the upper or the lower half plane, depending on whether u1 is greater than u2 or u2 is, or whether mod of u2 is greater than u1. And you'll find precisely the series expansion of 1 by 1 minus x squared, okay, if you put in these factors. So the moment you differentiate twice, you'll get a factor of omega. And if you just pick up the poles at omega beta equal to 2n pi, you'll see that you'll get the expansion of 1 by, I'm just using the fact that n of n minus 1. Okay? So you'll get 1 by 1 minus u1 by u2 squared. You multiply it by this u2 squared, and you'll get precisely this form. Okay? Okay. Sorry, I was a little quick in this calculation. But the statement is that if you put in this form of the, sorry, now I'm getting bad with my board. Sorry. Let me just write down the two-point function that I wanted. The claim is that this form of the two-point function is necessary to get this ultra-local form of the two-point function of the fields that you demand should be necessary if the field behaves like a good perturbative field. Okay. So let me just spend my last 2 minutes in trying to tell you what it is that we've done. So what I said was that you can quantize the field in front of the horizon and behind the horizon. I tried to explain this geometry, and then I said that when you quantize the field in front of the horizon, maybe I can pull this down. You get some. Sorry, I'm just wrapping up. Just 1 minute. Let me just summarize what we've done, and I'll tell you what we'll do tomorrow. Okay, so the statement is you have this horizon. You quantize the field in front of the horizon and behind the horizon. When you quantize the field in front of the horizon, you find some left and right movers. Okay, so you get some right movers, and you get some left movers. These left and right movers outside the horizon are related to each other by some boundary condition you have at the boundary. Okay? So the boundary condition relates these right movers and these left movers. Okay, you have modes which go like omega of t plus z star, and you have modes that go like omega of t minus z star, which are joined together by this boundary condition. You have the same structure behind the horizon. So this is the horizon. You have these right movers, and you have these left movers. Okay? The continuity of the field, this is what I call A. Okay? These are what I call A omega k. The continuity of the field tells you that the left movers behind the horizon are the same as the left movers in front of the horizon. Okay? So these are also the A omega k's. However, the right movers are some new degrees of freedom that are necessary to construct a local quantum field. These guys are some A twiddle omega k's. Okay? And even though they are independent modes in that they commute with these guys, they have some non-zero two-point function, which is very important, which I wrote down the board behind this. And they have some very specific non-zero two-point function that's important to make sure that the field is a good local field. Now, just before I end, let me just say there are a few other ways of understanding these right movers. These right movers are precisely what appeared in Hawking's original computation of Hawking radiation, for those of you who've studied that. These right movers in that computation appear as the rays which bounce off the r equal to 0 and come back out. Okay? So in Hawking's original computation, he had this geometry, and he had these rays which bounced off from r equal to 0 and came back out. Okay, so you had this horizon. It was formed by the collapse of matter. This is r equal to 0. And Hawking analyzed these rays which bounced off the r equal to 0 and formed these right movers. And these were the modes that he argued were entangled with the modes in front of the horizon that bounced off from just before the horizon formed. Okay? The other way of understanding these right movers is to think of an eternal black hole, and then these right movers are modes that are coming from the other asymptotic region. Okay? So there are various ways of understanding these right movers, but there's a problem both with Hawking's computation and with this computation of the eternal black hole, because Hawking's computation suffers from what's called a Trans-Planckian issue. If you really try and trace these modes back to the asymptotic past, you find that they get very highly boosted. On the other hand, this eternal black hole understanding suffers from the problem that in a collapsing geometry, you don't have the other asymptotic region. So what we have done here by means of this two-point function computation, which I tried to sketch, is we've had done a local derivation of Hawking's result. Just by imposing local conditions on the field and on two-point functions, we've argued that we have to have the structure of left and right movers, both in front and behind the horizon. The right movers have to commute, but yet have to be entangled with the modes in front of the horizon. Okay? So tomorrow, I'll say more about these objects and how you construct them from the boundary, but I'm run out of time, so maybe I'll stop here and we can have questions. Yes. You can think of it that way. Yes. Yes.
Okay. So if there's no further questions immediately, bring your questions back in half an hour. About 5 o'clock, we have a discussion session, and then we should have all our lecturers here, so you can ask further questions. So let's thank.